Good morning, dear students. Today we are going to learn about the breathing and exchange of gases, the second unit in the human physiology. Right. So let us see the first one. Cells require continuous supply of oxygen. Okay. Why the cells require continuous supply of oxygen means cells utilize oxygen for oxidation of glucose and other food materials for the liberation of energy. Okay, so unless the oxidation does not take place, we cannot get the energy. So for the liberation of energy, oxidation of glucose and other food material should take place. So that due to oxidation process, the cells are producing carbon dioxide, and this carbon dioxide which is liberated combines with the water and combines where and forms the carbonic acid. Right, so this is the introduction part. Breathing, exchange of oxygen from atmospheric air with carbon dioxide which is produced inside cells is called as breathing, and breathing is also commonly called as respiration. Then if we see the second time one, the respiration is of two types. So one is aerobic respiration and second one is anaerobic respiration. Aerobic respiration means which occurs in the presence of oxygen. Okay, so in aerobic respiration, complete breakdown of organic molecule occurs. So this is the glucose. So the glucose undergoes complete breakdown and yields water, carbon dioxide and also energy. Energy yielded during aerobic respiration is more. Then what about the anaerobic respiration? So anaerobic respiration occurs in the absence of oxygen and it is incomplete breakdown of organic molecules. So in anaerobic respiration, oxygen is not utilized by the cells. And what about energy? We see here the energy yield is also very less. So in anaerobic respiration, the energy is yielded is only 2 ATP, whereas in aerobic respiration, the energy yield is 36 ATP. See the next one. So let us see the respiratory organs in different animals. So the respiratory organs in different animal groups. So what are the respiratory organs in animals? For example, you take the lower invertebrates like sponges, cnidarians and flatworms. So remember here, the sponges means you have to remember the examples also, like cycon, leucocelina, spongilla, okay, chelina. So all these names you have to remember. Cnidarians means you have to remember the names like hydra, vobelia, adamsia, right? All these names you have to remember. Flatworms means you have to remember the tapeworm, liver fluke, blood fluke, dugesia, planaria. So in all these animals, is there any special respiratory structures? Means no, there are no any special respiratory structures. Then what are the respiratory organs? Means exchange of gases occurs through the general body surface by a process called as simple diffusion. And second one, you take the earthworms. Earthworms structure, there are no special structures. So what is the exchange of gases takes place through the moist skin. And aquatic arthropods and molluscans. So aquatic arthropods and molluscans means the arthropods which are living in the water, right? Arthropods which are living in the water, like king crab, crabs, bananas, prawns, everything. Right, so they are having a vascular structure called as gills. And terrestrial arthropods and molluscans, these animals which live on the surface of soil, they are having vascular bags called as lungs. And in limulus, the respiratory organ is book gills. Scorpion and spiders, the respiratory organs are book lungs. Fishes and larva of frog means, remember that it is also called as tadpole larva. So here the gills, reptiles, birds and mammal lungs. Then here what type of questions they can ask in the objective. Here we can get matching type of questions. Right, one side they'll give animal name and other side they'll give respiratory organ. Okay, you have to match these That is one type of question. Or directly animal and respiration, animal and respiratory organ. So directly they can ask about them. Given the, for example, they may ask you that what is the respiratory organs in spongilla, or what is the respiratory organs in Tinea solium. Like that, they can directly give the animal name and ask what is the respiratory organ in those animals, right? Let us see the next one now. Human respiratory system. Human respiratory system consists of nostrils, a pair of nostrils, a pair of internal nostrils, pharynx, larynx, trachea, bronchi, and lungs. So here, let us see here. First one, I'm going for external nostrils. So external nostrils are one pair. Okay. One pair. So these are the external nostrils. Where they are present? Present above the upper lip. Present above the upper lip. And external nostrils opens into nasal chamber. And here the internal nostrils will be there. These are the nasal chamber. The entire this one from here to here, it is nasal chamber. So the nasal chambers. Let us see the nasal chambers now. So nasal chambers are two. Then two nasal chambers are separated by a median bone called as nasal septum. This is one of the important question. So which separates the two nasal chambers means nasal septum. And each nasal chamber is having three parts. What are they? The first one is vestibular part. Vestibular part lies within the external nostril. Okay, the vestibular part lies within the external nostril. What the vestibular part consists of? The vestibular part consists of hair and sebaceous glands. Okay, what is the function of this hair and sebaceous gland in the vestibular part means they prevent entry of dust particles into the nasal chambers. That means the hair and the mucus or the sebum secreted by the sebaceous glands trap the dust particles in the vestibular part itself. Let us see the next one, respiratory part. Sorry. Respiratory part, it is the major part of nasal chamber. Okay, largest part of nasal chamber. And this respiratory part bears three tiny twisted bones called as nasal conchae. Okay, we see here. So here up to here, the respiratory, this is the nasal chamber up to here, and inside that there are three tiny twisted bones like this. These tiny twisted bones are called as nasal conchae, okay, or otherwise they are also called as turbinals. So these nasal conchae acts as natural air conditioners. So not nasal conchae, the respiratory part is acting as natural air conditioners. How? They release the moisture. That means the nasal respiratory part is releasing the moisture. So when the air enters into the nasal chambers, this moisture is added to the air. When the moisture is added to the air, the temperature of air comes to the body temperature. Okay? So it is acting as what? Natural air conditioner, and it warms up the air by releasing the moisture. And the last one is olfactory part. Here somewhere here the olfactory part is present. Olfactory part bears olfactory epithelium, and it is concerned with the sense of smell. Okay. And this nasal chamber opens into the internal nostrils. Internal nostrils opens into the pharynx. Then what about the pharynx? Pharynx is a common passage for air and food. And one more important question is this one. Pharynx is the part of digestive and respiratory tracts. They'll be asking you which is the common part for digestive and respiratory tract means it is a pharynx. Very important question this one. Let us see the next one. Larynx. So larynx is called as sound box. Okay. So in human beings, the sound is produced by the larynx. And larynx is a cartilaginous box because it is supported by 9 cartilages. These 9 cartilages, some are unpaired and some are paired. What are the unpaired? Thyroid, cricoid, and epiglottis. Paired are arytenoids, carniculate, and cuneiform. These are paired cartilages. So during the swallowing, glottis is covered by a leaf-like flap cartilage called as epiglottis. This epiglottis prevents entry of food and water into the trachea. So glottis is covered by a leaf-like flap structure called as cartilage. So what is the function of this epiglottis? Means epiglottis prevents the entry of food and water into the trachea. This is also one of the important question, and this is not there in the NCERT. Generally they won't ask, but this one they'll be asking you in the objective, right? Let's go for the next one. Vocal cords. So vocal cords are sound producing organs, right? And the vocal cords are made up of with fibroelastic cords. Where these vocal cords are present means they are present in the larynx. So remember here, this is the thyroid cartilage and these are the arytenoid cartilage, okay? So the vocal cords are extending between the thyroid and arytenoid cartilages. Vibrations of these vocal cords produces the sound. Then besides the vocal cords, there are also mucous membranes. So the blue color one is the mucous membrane. They are also called as false vocal cords. False vocal cords does not produce any sound. So if we see in the male, the male's voice is always low pitch, okay, and female, they are having high pitch voice. And this larynx protrudes on the ventral side like a prominence. That means the larynx is protruding in the neck region, in the anterior, in the ventral side. Then that one is called as Adam's apple. We already told you that the larynx is composed of 9 cartilages. In that, the thyroid cartilage is protruding out, and that one is called as Adam's apple, seen in males. So this is an application type of question. Sometimes they may ask, even though it is not there in the NCERT. Let's go for the next one. Trachea. So trachea is commonly called as windpipe. Okay, so it is arising from the lower part of larynx. So you can see the trachea here. So the trachea is supported by C-shaped cartilaginous rings. So what is the use of C-shaped cartilaginous rings? Means the cartilaginous rings are full on the ventral side and they are off on the dorsal side. Like this it looks. So this one is like this. Okay, this one is like this. So they are full on the ventral side and off on the dorsal side. What is the use of this cartilaginous rings? Means cartilaginous rings prevent the collapsing of trachea in absence of air. Then up to where the trachea is extending. Trachea extends up to 5th thoracic vertebrae. So they extends up to 5th thoracic vertebrae. So trachea bifurcates into two bronchi called as primary bronchi at the level of 5th thoracic vertebrae. At the level of 5th thoracic vertebrae. And the trachea is internally lined by pseudo-stratified columnar epithelium. This is the columnar epithelial cells. It is lined by pseudo-stratified columnar epithelial cells. So this is also one of the important question. And this is important question. This is one important question. These three are important points. So up to where it is extending 5th thoracic vertebrae. Where it bifurcates into primary bronchi at the level of 5th thoracic vertebrae. Trachea is internally lined by pseudo-stratified ciliated epithelium. Now let's go for the next one, bronchi. Right. So now if you see the previous one here, this one is the primary bronchi. Okay. This one is the primary bronchi. And this primary bronchi divides into secondary bronchi like this. I'll show you in the diagram. So the primary bronchi is supported by C-shaped cartilaginous rings. And the primary bronchi enters into the lungs. In the lungs, the primary bronchi divides into secondary bronchi. Secondary bronchi is also supported by C-shaped cartilaginous rings. Secondary bronchi divides into tertiary bronchi. Tertiary bronchi is also supported by C-shaped cartilaginous rings. The tertiary bronchi divides repeatedly and forms bronchioles. Like primary bronchioles, secondary bronchioles, tertiary bronchioles, terminal bronchioles and respiratory bronchioles. Up to terminal bronchioles, it is supported by C-shaped cartilaginous rings. Now let us see the sequence. primary bronchioles, secondary bronchioles, tertiary bronchioles, terminal bronchioles, respiratory bronchioles. Respiratory bronchioles opens into alveolar ducts, alveolar ducts opens into alveolar sac opens into alveoli. So this is the sequence. So this is also one of the important questions. Right, let us see now. Now you can see here, bronchioles. So this one, I'll note it with a color pens. So this is the primary bronchi. Okay, now I'm going with a different color. This is the secondary bronchi. Okay, this is the bronchioles, terminal tertiary bronchi. So these are the bronchioles. Primary, secondary, terminal, like this. These are the bronchioles. And these are the alveolar sacs. Alveolar sacs. So, bronchi, bronchioles. Okay, bronchi and bronchioles. You can see here. Alright, we go for the next one. Supported by, right. So, what are the structures that are supported by cartilaginous rings? Means trachea, bronchi, and initial bronchioles means up to terminal bronchiole. These three are supported by C-shaped cartilaginous rings. Now let us see the next one, alveoli. Alveoli are structural and functional units of lungs. And these are the units of exchange of gases. Alveoli are internally lined by simple squamous epithelium. Very important point, this one. Okay. Then how many alveoli are present means there are 300 million alveoli in two lungs. That means each lung consists of 150 million alveoli. Now let us see the lungs. Lungs are two and lungs are asymmetrical and color of lungs is pinkish. Where they are present? They are present in the thoracic chamber on either side of the heart. So you can see this is the heart. Here the heart is present. Either side of the heart and above the diaphragm. So this is the diaphragm. This is the diaphragm. So, on either side of heart, above the diaphragm. And lung consists of two lobes. One is the right lobe and second one is the left lobe. Right lobe is larger when compared to the left lobe. Right lobe consists of three lobes. One is the superior lobe, middle lobe, inferior lobe. Okay. This is also application type of question. You can ask. But whereas the left lung, there are only two lobes. Superior lobe and inferior lobes. And the lungs are covered by pleura. The coverings of lungs are called as pleura. Right. So what are that pleura? So outer layer is called as visceral pleura. Right. You can see this one. This one is the visceral pleura. Sorry. Outer layer is called as parietal pleura. This is the parietal pleura. Parietal pleura is attached to the thoracic chamber or it lines the thoracic chamber. And this yellow color one is a visceral pleura. Visceral pleura is covering the surface of lung. So, visceral pleura covers the surface of the lung. So, in between this parietal pleura and visceral pleura, there is a gap. You can see here. I am filling that one with green ink. Yeah. So, this is a gap is there. That gap is nothing but pleural cavity. And this pleural cavity is completely filled up with a fluid called as pleural fluid. So, what is the use of this pleural fluid? Pleural fluid reduces the friction on the lungs during expansion and relaxations. So, the thoracic chambers are expanding. They pull the parietal pleura. At that time, it reduces the friction on the lungs. Right. Then, human respiratory tract is divided into two parts. One is the conducting part and one is the respiratory part. From where to where it is called as conducting part. From external nostrils to terminal bronchioles is called as conducting part. What is the function of conducting part? Conducting part transports air, clears dust particles, humidifies air, warms up air up to body temperature. Then what about the respiratory part or exchange part? Respiratory part means it begins with the respiratory bronchioles, which opens into the alveolar ducts opens into the alveolar sacs opens into the alveoli. So, in the exchange part, only exchange of gases takes place. These two are very, very important questions. They'll be asking you from where to where the conducting part is present, which is called as respiratory part or exchange part. What happens in the exchange part? What is the function of conducting part? So all these things are the important questions. Now let's go for the next one. Thoracic chamber. So this one is thoracic chamber. So this one I'll explain in a diagrammatic way. Actually, if the lungs are present, if you see the lungs are present in anatomically airtight chamber called as thoracic chamber. Okay. The thoracic chamber is formed dorsally by vertebral column. So vertebral column is present backside. It is not shown here. Ventrally by sternum. So this is the sternum. And laterally by ribs. These are the ribs. Laterally by ribs. And posteriorly diaphragm. Posteriorly diaphragm. Right? So what is this anatomical setup mean? This anatomical setup of thoracic chamber indicates that any change in the volume of thoracic chamber also alters the change in the volume of lungs. That means if you see here, the outer pleural membrane is attached to the thoracic chamber. If the thoracic chambers are expanding, they are pulling the pleural membrane. As they are pulling the pleural membrane, the lungs are also expanding. That means if the volume of thoracic chamber changes, the volume of lungs also changes. If the volume of thoracic chamber decreases, the volume of lungs also decreases. So what is the anatomical setup means? In this anatomical setup, the thoracic chamber can alter the volume of lungs. So we don't have any capacity to alter the volume of our own lungs. We cannot change the volume of our lungs, but we can expand and abandon the thoracic chamber, right? Thoracic chamber can alter the volume of lungs. Right, so the anatomical setup of lungs in thoracic is that any change in the volume of thoracic cavity will be reflected in the lung cavity. Okay, so such arrangement is essential for breathing as we cannot directly alter the pulmonary volume. That means we cannot directly alter the pulmonary volume means we cannot directly change the volume of lungs. Right. So this completes the introduction part of the lungs. Up to lungs we have completed. Then we have to go for the mechanism of breathing, respiration, mechanism of breathing, volumes and capacities, exchange of gases in the next video. Okay. So please follow. I'll conduct one examination in the breathing and exchange of gases. Thank you.